Okay, let's start. So also on behalf of Mariette, I would like to welcome you at this symposium. And it's a very special symposium because it accompanies the inaugural lecture of Mariette this afternoon. So as you may know, Mariette is our head of the department. And since 1.5 years, I think now, and when I speak for myself, I'm very happy that we have an incredibly education-minded head of the department. So, and I think this is shared by a lot of colleagues. And I think this symposium confirms that once again. So she is also very experienced herself. So she was a senior fellow at the Center for Academic Teaching at the University of Utrecht, where research into education is one of the important pillars, and she recently completed a course in which she also learned to set up and implement this herself. She has used this in her integrity projects for the past years. And I think we can learn a lot of that. So this symposium brings her three great loves together. So education, integrity, and research. And I'm always wondering why we are not doing so much research into education at the moment. So it's under development at the moment, and we wish to do a lot of research into education, but a lot of times we will not do that. So I hope we can learn a lot today, and I think we can learn a lot of all the integrity projects before the break, before the lunch break. Integrity will, all the integrity projects from around Europe will present their projects, and after the lunch break, the presenters will tell something about ethics education. So I would like to introduce the first speaker. So that's Irma Meijerman. She's a senior fellow at the Center for Academic Teaching at Utrecht University. Her home base is pharmacy, and she has contributed as a pioneer in honors programs for pharmacy students. SOTL stands for Scholarship in Teaching and Learning and combines education and research by stimulating research into education. We are honored that she is willing to tell us more about the SOTL movement and what it is and what it can mean for research into education and training. So the floor is yours.
Okay, well, thank you very much. And thank you, Mariette, for inviting me. We were senior fellows, so it's a pity that you left us for this university, but of course this university gains a lot by having you now here. So you invited me, and I was invited here to tell more about educational scholarship and what it is. First, let me introduce myself a bit more so that you know who is talking to you. I have a background in toxicology and cell biology, and before my research was focused on the pharmacokinetics of oncolytic drugs. And pharmacokinetics is the behavior of drugs in the human body. And I'm part of the Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, and I teach in toxicology and pharmacology. But where I know Mariette from, and what I've done, been working on the last 4 years, is scholarship of teaching and learning. And I will explain what it is and what it embraces and what it can do for you in a moment. But as a senior fellow, we established SOTL grants for teachers within our university, small grants for to support them. We have now a yearly SOTL conference. We have a special interest group in SOTL, and we have a SOTL advocates project in which we want to have ambassadors of SOTL within every faculty. And at the moment, I'm also the Vice President Europe of the International Society of Scholarship of Teaching and Learning. So this conference, the title of this conference, Ethics and Integrity, Education in Development, moving towards evidence-based education. So evidence-based education, what is it? What do we mean by evidence-based education? I think that's something important to think about. So what is it? Why do we want this? Is it something modern? Is it something fashionable? Or is it really important? So why should we do evidence-based education research? And if we want to do it, how should we do it? And that's what my talk is focusing on today. So first, what? What is evidence-based education? So when you go into literature and when you look for examples on the internet, you see that it uses evidence from research. And personally, I don't like the word evidence, because in teaching and learning, evidence is very difficult. What is evidence? And that's mainly because the context is always very important when you talk about evidence in teaching and learning. Every context is different. Every university is different. Every discipline is different. So it's very difficult to talk about evidence. And also, it's about teacher experience. So what is then evidence-based? I personally prefer research-informed, but I will tell you more about it with this. So let's talk about, if you think about evidence-based education, what is it then? So first of all, people who are teaching have to be trained in how they teach. So it's about the pedagogy. It's about methods. How can you teach? What are effective ways to teach? How, for example, do you give a good lecture? How do you involve students in your teaching? So that's teaching. And then we have what I call scholarly teaching. And scholarly teaching is more or less the evidence-based teaching. When I talk about scholarly teaching, I have evidence-based teaching in my mind. Because when you talk about scholarly teaching, you talk about using things that we already know from other research, teaching and learning literature to inform your teaching practice. So it's really about the teaching practice, scholarly teaching, and using literature, experience from others within your own discipline to help develop your own teaching practice. So that's scholarly teaching. And I put evidence-based education over there because I think those, when you think about those two things, scholarly teaching, research-informed teaching, it's almost similar. You can go one step further. And one step further is that you don't only use a scholarly approach to your teaching, so you don't only use literature to inform your teaching, but you also investigate yourself what effect your teaching has on the learning of your students. And learning in a broad sense, learning is not only about knowledge, it can also be about attitudes, it can also be, for example, about motivation, about creative thinking. So these are the three steps. So scholarly teaching leads can go to scholarship of teaching and learning. I personally think it's already very good that we try to do more scholarly teaching. But I hope that more and more teachers will make the step from scholarly teaching to scholarship of teaching and learning. So just to distinguish a bit, this is a figure that we use at Utrecht University. Scholarship of teaching and learning is one of the balls that you see here. It's part of educational scholarship. And scholarly teaching is all about your own teaching. It's about your classroom. It's about your teaching practice. So it's, and the aim of scholarship of teaching and learning of SODL is always to improve the learning of your own students. The aim is always improving teaching, improving learning of students. When you go for other parts of educational scholarship can be discipline-based educational research. For example, in the medical field, you see a lot of people that do discipline-based educational research. That very often is aimed at a whole discipline. For example, certain topics within medicine. For example, how can we improve in general learning of our co-assistants? Or how should we improve a whole curriculum? So that's more at a somewhat higher level. So SODL is at a classroom level. discipline-based educational research often use more educational theories is at a what higher level. But they are not separate. It's a continuum. So very often what you see is that people that do subtle advance in doing discipline-based educational research, but that's not needed. And of course, we have higher education as a discipline, higher educational research, who do research on the learning of students in higher education in general. But those three influence each other, help each other, and foresee each other of information. So why then should we do this subtle, this scholarly teaching, this subtle on the thing? Let's look at this example of this cat. So what this cat is doing, he sees this glass and he thinks, I wonder if it bounces, and he throws it down. You can imagine what happens. And he says, well, I try it again. We all laugh about it, but this is what very often happens in the classroom. As a teacher, you experience a problem, and then you say to yourself, well, my students have low grades for the exam. Well, let's throw in another lecture, see what happens. Maybe that helps. Well, the next exams are just as bad. Well, then maybe they need another workshop. So it's all trial and error what we do. And with scholarship of teaching and learning and scholarly teaching, you can improve it. Also, looking at the theme of this conference, integrity and ethics, if you talk about academic integrity, can we tell us ourselves that we use trial and error methods in our teaching, while we, on the other hand, say academic integrity is about rigor in research? So that's also something that you might think about. What are other reasons why people should be involved in scholarly teaching? What can we benefit from it? So one thing is the example of the cat. How do we know that students really learn what we want them to learn? Of course, you have exams, and you're all familiar with student evaluations, which most of the time are only about student satisfaction and don't say anything about the learning. And with exams, you only test knowledge. You don't test motivation. You really don't have any idea what they know. So SODL can help you gain a better insight in what students really learn. And on the other hand, it's this rigor in research. Aren't we responsible as academics to contribute to the knowledge that we have about the learning as students? It's a discussion point, especially in this audience. But I think as educators at academia, we have this responsibility that we improve what we know about teaching and learning of our own students. And on the other hand, there's a lot of discussion going on within academia about the position of education and research. And by doing more research, doing more inquiry into our student learning, for example, through SODL, I think and I believe, and other people also are convinced about that we make our teaching more credible, so that we make the position of our education more credible, and that it obtains a better position towards the disciplinary research. So those are reasons. But yeah, it's all about student learning. So one of the other important reasons to get involved in SODL is that we know from research that it really benefits student learning. It improves students' learning, it improves student satisfaction. What it also does is that it stimulates teachers to use more innovative teaching methods. Using innovative teaching methods is not the goal, but what you often see is that teachers stick to what they know, workshops, lectures, and by going more into SODL research, for example, what you see is that the teachers are more likely to use other types of teaching methods that might improve the learning of their own students. So it's not a goal in itself, but I think it is, it's an important benefit of SODL. What is also going on within university, for example, at Utrecht University, is that the many universities want to have opportunities for teachers to also develop, professionalize and make a career. And scholarship of teaching and learning is a very important, powerful manner of teachers to improve themselves, to develop themselves. So it's an important way of professional development of teachers. So then, what is it for me, in it for me? Of course, these are all very good benefits. They are for the university, they are for the students. But as a teacher, why should you be involved in scholarship of teaching and learning? What are the benefits for you? So first, it's because you have the opportunity with SODL to explore something that you are interested in. You look at your students, you might have certain questions, and then you go more into depth in something that really interested you. That would also be my advice to when you get engaged in scholarly teaching or SODL. Take a subject, take a part of your teaching that you really like. Take something that you are passionate about. And that would make SODL more fun. This week I had a meeting with people that were involved in SODL and I asked them, what does scholarship of teaching and learning mean to you? And a couple of them said, fun. So that's important to realize that because you can explore questions that you like, but it also improves talking with your colleagues about teaching and learning. Being engaged in scholarly teaching, being engaged in SODL, makes you part of a community where you can exchange experience about teaching and learning and have more interesting and more in-depth conversations with your colleagues about teaching and learning. And I already talked about this innovation, that teachers that are involved in SODL very often are more likely to innovate their teaching. That's also because SODL encourages teachers to think more deeply about teaching and learning. What is teaching and learning? How do my students learn in the classroom? What makes my subject so difficult for students? And SODL stimulates you to think more deeply about what is really going on with your students. And also, it improves your teaching and it keeps your teaching fresh. So it's not like every year doing the same, but it's continuously thinking about what do I experience in my classroom, how can I improve this, and how can I improve this in a scholarly manner. So, and then it's about how. How can you do scholarship of teaching and learning? So where do you find support? Because for most of you, maybe this might be a very new concept. It is not easy, because most of the teachers that are involved in SODL come from a different disciplinary background, have no experience in finding, for example, educational literature. I'm from a science background. I have no experience from in the past with, for example, qualitative research. While on the other hand, people from humanities, for example, very often have no experiences with quantitative research. So how can you support teachers with doing SODL, but how can you find your own way if you are from a certain specific disciplinary background? So what we did at Utrecht is we developed, and I'm going to get it here, this really nice Utrecht roadmap of scholarship of teaching and learning. I brought some copies, they're under the shed. If they are not enough, please contact me, have a look at the website of Utrecht University. What did we do? We took the 5 basic principles of scholarship of teaching and learning as the basis of this roadmap. One is that it's grounded in context, and that is probably what you should call evidence-based. So you have to look at the literature, have to look what is already known about the learning of my students and about the teaching of students in my own discipline. And it's grounded in the context of what is already known about student learning. It's an inquiry focused on student learning. In English, they have the word inquiry. In Dutch, we only have onderzoek. But research very often sounds very heavy, and it can scare teachers from getting involved in this. So I try, and we try to avoid the word research as much as possible. It's an inquiry into your student learning. It's approving your own teaching. And you do that by using certain research methods, yes. But it's not theoretically based educational research that you are getting involved in. It's classroom. It's to improve the practice within your own classroom. It should be methodologically sound, so you should use methods that will answer the question that you have about your own teaching. What I didn't mention, and what I realized just when I got in was in the train towards this conference, there's no ethics here, but ethics is a very important topic when it comes to methodology sound, because you have to think about what am I going to measure with my students, is this ethical, how I'm going to deal with it, and there's a lot of discussion about that going on at the moment. Students as partners, try to involve students. It's important to get students involved in what you are doing. And appropriately public, and that's a very important aspect of SOTL. You have to share it with other people. So, and sharing does not necessarily mean that you publish it in peer-reviewed journals. You can also share it with your colleagues at a conference like this, at our yearly Utrecht Scholarship of Teaching and Learning conference. So they're all writing a blog, so there are all kinds of manners how you can share your SOTL work, but you should share it. The moment it stays with you and you don't inform anything about it, we don't call it Scholarship of Teaching and Learning, because then it will not improve or help other teachers. So this is basically, I will not go into depth because I can talk hours about the whole roadmap, but this is basically what we have done and how the roadmap looks. And the roadmap is, of course, not this figure, but a nice booklet with 8 pages of... It's a manual, it's a guideline for people who want to get engaged in SOTL. But, of course, there are all kinds of other manners. You can go to your own university and try to find whether there are people experienced with SOTL that can help you. There are also a lot of resources available, very nice books. I can really recommend the book edited by Nancy Chick, for example. And she tells more about the background of SOTL, but also gives some guidelines about how you can do a SOTL project. And of course, there is the International Society of Scholarship of Teaching and Learning. And this society embraces SOTL. It's a community of SOTL. They organize a yearly conference where I will go to on Saturday. It's a yearly conference, and it's a very nice, welcoming community. Of course, iSOTL can be very far away. There's now also every 2 years an EuroSOTL conference in Europe, a bit smaller than the large one. So if you are really interested in the iSOTL, or want to know more, you can go to their website, or you can always email me, because I'm the Vice President Europe. So my task is to get more people in the Netherlands involved in iSOTL. So if you want to know more, please let me know. So I want to end with this one, which is a really nice picture of the photographer Erik Johansson. And I think SOTL is about finding your own way, finding the topics that you are interested in, and then having some help with some people. But it's very important that with evidence-based education, as the title is, with scholarly teaching and SOTL, as I would say, you can find your own way and do the things that you are interested in and make your own road to improve your own teaching and the learning of your students. So that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you.
Are there any questions?
Thank you for a very nice presentation. Are there any questions for Irma? Yes, over there.
Yeah, well, it's not easy because you are also from, if you are from the LUMC, you also have a scientific medical background. And I myself, I'm from a medical background, and I'm a toxicologist, cell biologist. So I was trained in doing experiments with cells. And then you have one group of cells that you expose to a certain compound and the other not. So what is the endpoint? That very much depends on the problem or the question that you have in your own teaching. So, for example, let's say that you see that your students are not coming prepared to your classroom. And you wonder why that is. And then you go into literature and you think, well, it might be because they find the topic too difficult. So you restructure the assignments that you do, and then you are going to measure, are they coming prepared or not? So not assessment scores. On the other hand, I also have had teachers who said, well, I really don't know what motivates my students. I have no idea. I would really like to know what motivates them, what drives them in my subject, in my classroom. Then I do an interview or a focus group. And other things that you can use, for example, are products that students make. It's interviews, it's focus groups, it's products that students make. It can be everything. It can be clicks on a certain internet environment. But it really depends on the question that you have. So when you look at the roadmap, you're first trying to find out what is really happening in my classroom. You do some literature research about it. Then you formulate a certain research question. And depending on that research question, you have to find your methodologically sound method to collect data. And very often, most of the time, even that are not great. But all kinds of other stuff, questionnaires, validated questionnaires, can be everything. And that is what makes this difficult, of course, for people who start with this, because they have no idea. So the roadmap is very good. But what we see is that teachers do need some extra guidance very often. Or, for example, what we have now within our own Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, a group of teachers who are involved in this, who help each other, like a community of practice. Does this answer your question?
Yes, I'll give you the...
I have the same question, but it's a little bit phrased a little bit more critically, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I don't mind.
And allow me to start with an observation that Wittgenstein made towards the end of his life. And he wrote a book on doubt, and he said, mostly questions, and the question that he started with is, if I raise my left hand, how do I know it's my left hand? And there are things we may not know, and I think my question to you will be, if you're talking about evidence-based approaches, you said evidence is actually the context, but what evidence suggests that you know in advance what you're working towards to?
Yep.
And if you know the work of Gert Pista, he made a powerful argument in an article that's called "What Works, Why What Works Won't Work." He argues that you, in higher education, you don't know what you're working towards to.
Yeah.
And therefore, evidence, grades or whatever you want, you know, people showing up at your classrooms or you know, being interested in whatever you do, that may not be your parameter. It may be something that is established in the course of your process.
Yeah.
And then you don't really have evidence. So that's my a little bit more critical question, which is basically the same as the previous speaker.
Yeah,
thank you.
But I can answer that very well, I think, because I think that's what I mentioned in the beginning. I don't like the word evidence when it comes to scholarship of teaching and learning. Because I think what it's all about you want to improve something that goes wrong in your classroom. There is a problem with the learning of your students. And then you go into literature to find out, did other people have the same problem, and what did they do? But you don't. That will always be in another context. It might be in the same discipline, but it's different type of students, different countries, different educational system. But you can use the information they have to find out, would it be something that could work with my students? So you try it, and then you measure whether it really did work or not. But it's not like that what you find in literature will really predict what's going to happen, because that's not possible. But it gives you some clues, and it gives you more clues than the cat just bouncing off the glass and saying, well, let's try something else, let's try this. So looking into literature, having somewhat more knowledge about how do students learn can help you design your teaching, but you can never predict what's really going to happen, because it's always a different context, it's always different. Even in the same subject, with the same course, we all know, if you're a teacher, you know that every study year is different. Every year the students change, and sometimes you have good years, sometimes you have bad years. And so you never know what's really going to happen, but the evidence, or more the research that has already been done, can give you a more direction into an improving of your teacher that will probably lead to better results than just using the trial and error method. Does that answer your question? Yeah, well, that's good. Okay. Maybe we should have a coffee sometime and discuss it. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. There was one. Yeah, there are more questions, but there is not more time. So I'm so sorry. I think we have to leave it like this. And maybe if you have questions, feel free to contact Irma. Yeah. Do we know your email address?
Yeah, I have to leave, unfortunately, so I cannot stay. But if you want to contact me, Mariette knows my email address. There's also an email address on the roadmap. And also, if you Google my name and Irma Meijerman UU, you will probably also very easily find my email address. So feel free, feel welcome to contact me if you have any more questions or want more copies of the roadmap. But there's also PDF available online.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much. I have a present for you, or we have a present for you. Thank you for coming.
Okay.
And good luck in Canada.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks.